This I actually didn't, I meant to warm up on this, so we will see. This one's kind of a tricky one. Make sure to follow with me. Check out when I first start playing, kind of look up and see how I'm doing this. This is track 5, please. Something about your playing that stands out. If let's just say, for example, I'm playing this excerpt and it's at an audition, and I'm in the first round and there's a big screen up, I'm not going to do that. There's no way that's ever going to be as clean and consistent. Even though it's cool, it's never going to be as clean and consistent as, right? One of the big problems with tambourine, though, is that when we play soft, we tend to kind of need it to rest on something. We kind of play it like a snare drum, without using sticks. That's one of the list of pet peeves, and don't ever use sticks on tambourine if you can help it. Then when we have long, drawn-out crescendos, crescendi, whatever they're called, at some point you have to figure out how to get the thing off of your knee. This particular excerpt, it doesn't really work very well. I'm supposed to get louder and louder and louder and then play a role at the end of it. So this one I literally spent years and years sort of cultivating that technique and finding out, okay, I have a way I'll play it early on at an audition, maybe. Maybe even live, I might do it like this. But if the screen comes down and I need to somehow be memorable and impressive, I'm going to do something that's maybe a little showier. You know, I may not even be a showy player, but I've just learned through the years you got to do things that make you stand out. This, I think, you know, I don't know if there's going to be too many people willing to try it like that, because it's a bit of a risk. I mean, to be fair, it's not the most consistent thing in the world. But it's fun and it looks cool. So, yes, any other questions?
Can you show us how you would do it if you were in audition?
Well, I would say early on, I would start like this. And then as I got louder, I would have to keep it on my knee. So, and you can see what happens with this technique. As you get louder, you kind of lose the definition a little bit. So either way, this, it's hard. There really is no great solution that I found to this excerpt. Like I said, when the screen comes on, and I've done this before, I've literally stood there, and there was a stand in the way, and I literally like kind of made sure that the people could see, because I was like, this is cool. It may not sound as good, but it looks good. And that's a big, big thing about percussion too. And you guys already know this, you've found this before. People hear what they see when it comes to percussion, you know? So again, that's a case of where I gotta kind of hide behind the stand and it's on my knee. I can't have it visual. This way, I kind of can control where I hold the tambourine. And you can also sort of do a crescendo. I literally once did this in a performance. I couldn't get it soft enough, and I wanted to toss the jingle. So I literally turned my back and started playing it like this, and then had this big sort of, you know. I mean, it looked very silly, but it worked. I mean, it was the same concept, which I'm going to show you in the next excerpt, of sort of using what's in front of you as a percussionist. Most of the time, we're in the back. There are people in front of us. So here's an example, Polovtsian Dances, where I again will do it in a slightly different way than most people do it. Okay, let's have track 6, please. I'll catch this one halfway through, too. essentially the concept is the same. I'm using the fact that the jingles are striking on that side and that side to give myself a rhythm. That's my accent, right? And the little circles that you wrote, that was Borden's silly little way of writing an accent, I think, basically. And I'm just... And I can't really get as soft as I want, nor can I really get as articulate as I want, but here, on the start, and then about halfway through, I'm playing softer, but I'm also using the fact that there's people at about this height right in front of me. And you put that tambourine in any instrument, you put it directly behind somebody, the sound gets swallowed up a little bit. So that's using the ensemble to create dynamics for you. Kind of a neat thing to do. Don't tell me when you're doing that, though. Yes?
You think that when Borden and these other composers wrote these parts, that even perhaps that's probably what they wanted?
I would love to know. I definitely have some questions for some of these guys.
Maybe it wasn't so like hyper-competitive and like laser-accurate as it is today.
I think you're probably right about that. And that sounds great. It's kind of like, boy, you know, in the good old days, we used to do it like this. But you gotta change and adapt, you know. I kind of agree. I tend to think the visual aspect trumps sound. I think they're 50-50, to tell you the truth. But
he definitely expresses the character.
Yeah. I think so too. So we're going to do another example of the same piece later on, where he actually switches to a different grouping of five, and I'll show you my solution to that. In particular, watch the very, very end. Let's go to track 7, please. I want to pick it up here. I respect the way that people did it, but I kind of want to be unique and interesting.